Thanks for joining us once again. This is Greg for Teslafaninsight. Our focus today is on our weekly Tesla semi. As usual, the goal is to sort of take a look at sort of new aspects of the semi that may not have been covered previously. So I managed to, at any rate, what I'd like to focus on today is the fact that Tesla is sort of becoming the savior of the entire logistics business, given new rules that are coming out of California relative to the electrification of fleets, is our concentration for today. We're also going to be taking a look at some new things I've learned about logistics from an encounter with an expert in the area that I was very surprised by in terms of predicting the economy relative to what's going on with logistics, particularly the movement of freight between all ports in Asia and the United States. This is Greg for Teslafaninsight. Thanks once again for joining us. If this is your first time, welcome. If you're a repeat visitor, welcome back. We also want to thank our Patreon supporters. If you enjoy the show and like better ideas on investing and trading, please join us on Patreon. So we do have a show coming out tomorrow focused on, you know, Tesla stock price being down relative to the departure of the CFO. And we do have some ideas that were shared by a few different entities in that regard. So we look forward to covering that for tomorrow's show. But for today, we just wanted to review some things relative to the semi and logistics. So what happened is that I actually had a meeting with an executive at one of the largest logistics companies in the United States. We had a brief conversation about what was going on, as you know, with Yellow going bankrupt. But we also were concentrating on what was going on with his help with sort of the back end of logistics. In particular, what's happening is that the folks at Tesla are helping sort of domestic and foreign entities make the move relative to trucking from, you know, diesel over to, hopefully it's EV, but there are a lot of people using hydrogen as a stepping stone towards full electrification. Now, why is it a big deal that we're talking anything about electrification? What I really thought was going on right now is that Tesla was helping a small group of large companies transition themselves slowly into electrification. Well, it turns out that one of the major processes in electricity and electrification of transport and vehicles is rules being installed by California. As you know, as of, let's say, 5 years ago, Greater Los Angeles was about 34 million population. So let's say we have 5 years, you know, 2% per year growth. So theoretically, LA's market is 45 million people. Then add in the Bay Area, let's say net about 8 million people. So out of a 320 million people in the United States, between Los Angeles and San Francisco, greater areas, you know, we're talking, you know, 50 million, 55 million. So relatively, I mean, it's not even half the population of the country. But what's going on is those are fairly wealthy individuals. And what tends to happen is that when there are laws that are installed by California, it's easier for manufacturers to simply bake in the California laws rather than just saying, forget California, we'll do everything across the country according to the laws that we're able to install in those areas. And so as a result, what's happening is that, you know, California is looking to go complete electrification by mid, you know, like I believe it's 2035. So we have to step backwards to a lot of entities, especially shippers, starting to ship over to electrification as a way to move freight rather than stay where they currently are. So I was kind of surprised to learn that those rules are influencing things now in terms of the discussion and planning process for large companies. So it kind of explains why Schneider, in combination now with Pepsi to deliver to their facilities and others are now moving into electrification more rapidly than I expected, frankly. As you know, Tesla does have a vehicle out and seems to be the best in class, but the nightmare is, what's the real cost of those vehicles going to be, given that, you know, there are going to be a lot of them produced over time? And I really thought that why Tesla really makes a difference in trucking in this space is that large organizations, unless they're assisted by state money, were sort of lining up to make the argument that the rules should be relaxed to give more time, or that it wasn't realistic to run these vehicles in the manner described because there wasn't enough power or for other reasons. So basically, Tesla is sort of messing up the plan of slow walking this. And if you even look in Europe, you have the same thing going, where the standards for the electric trucks that are being put in there seem to be moving towards, well, what is Tesla doing in that regard? And we expect you guys to be able to meet those standards as well. And the European manufacturers, I'm particularly focused on Daimler because they have the largest market share of trucks globally, is sort of moving towards, yes, they have electric vehicles, they're kind of not very viable based on range and other reasons, and they're moving towards a hydrogen stepping stone move as they too move towards electric. Now, I chose to do this show today sort of in stream, because I did have a good meeting in terms of learning a lot about logistics I actually didn't know and that I thought were useful in understanding how to invest and trade better. So to finish off sort of our truck discussion for today, one of the things that we've been sort of lurking around for is other ways to use the electrified truck. In particular, it's my belief that we're going to end up in a situation where, if you'll recall, Texas is having some serious problems because they're not interlocked with the rest of the grids in the country with power outages. We had them in the winter and a lot of people froze to death, and then we've had some issues this past year, but now we're also having some issues in the summer as we have extra heat and now there's a need for electricity to provide air conditioning. So one of the things I believe is going to be a use for the semi coming forward is actually, in essence, powering a whole town with a semi. So I expect that we're going to see Tesla semis being delivered to Texas, you know, in the form of sitting in the facilities there. And if there's an emergency need, one could power up the factory with that power, or you could even deploy those vehicles to Texas cities that are in need of power on a temporary basis. And in theory, that 850 kWh vehicle could end up being the savior of a lot of lives if in fact the Tesla semi was sent in. Now, I particularly wanted to bring this up because one entity that has not shown any orders for Tesla semis is FEMA. And when you look at tornadoes hitting and other things relative to temporary power, I think that could be a really good use to rapidly move in power to drive cities in the process of their recoveries. So I wanted to run this by you in general because I just think that there's a lot of ways the Tesla semi will make a difference, and it's making a difference already because logistics and other entities are being measured by government entities on their ability to deliver a solution comparable to what Tesla is doing. So even if they don't have huge numbers out there, they're forcing the whole industry forward rather than backward in this process. As we've discussed before, I do believe that what actually happened in Germany is that one of the reasons German trucks split from cars is it changed the rules in terms of how much cash has to be put out by the separate Daimler entities, truck and car, because they're being fined according to how many electric vehicles they have on the road, both truck side and car side. And one way to reduce the pain of those EU fines is simply split the companies, and now you have a smaller bill that'll go to both sides as they build numbers to eliminate the fines associated with not going electric. So I'm impressed. I'm surprised and impressed. I have been learning about the Pepsis of the world, the Budweisers of the world. Obviously, Coca-Cola and all these other entities are going electric. And Elon/Tesla, I think, is going to make a big difference in how this happens. So congratulations to both. The final thing I wanted to cover today that I've been learning about and got a chance to learn in my logistics interview was sort of the cycle of logistics over the last, let's say, 5 to 7 years, and how those logistics are affecting the global economy. In particular, what I was surprised to learn about was that there was a cycle of logistics that happened. So when I'm talking about logistics, I'm specifically talking more focused on a movement of freight, and particularly the movement of freight from Asia into the United States. So what was explained to me is that during the pandemic, there was a huge spike in consumer demand for consumer goods, electronics, all these different things. And that was partially driven by the stimulus checks. So what happened is people cramped up at home, were spending a lot, and many of those goods were coming from Asia. So what you saw was a huge spike in demand for logistics. So it got more expensive to ship. It became, it just created, if you will, a logistic environment that maybe had never existed before. And so both, we had a huge thing going on where, let's say, a Walmart, for example, had all this demand that they had to meet, and they were buying sort of ship space to move those goods. Same thing with the other large and small entities. So it just resulted in a boom for China, for example, a boom in the shipping industry, et cetera. Then what happened was, as the pandemic slid downwards and people used their stimulus checks, you had an overcapacity situation. So what you had happen is a lot of companies went into a sort of burn off what they had mode. And then as they completed that, we're now somewhat in that cycle where we're going to see growth once again, because while that inventory is being bled off, we've now gotten through that period, and now we're looking forward to what's coming up. So I was introduced to something new called the Journal of Commerce. And what that journal is useful for is you can somewhat anticipate where the economy is going based on both the direction of shipping rates and what the shipping rates are currently at. So the latest sort of update on that situation is that we just had a spike in rates driven by the fact that Walmart has announced, or Walmart has increased their orders from all of their suppliers in the Orient, and they've also secured shipping to carry those increased orders into ports throughout the world, particularly West Coast ports for the United States. So I just think this is big news, and it's a new metric or way to anticipate direction of the economy, how strong it might be, looking through the eyes of some of the biggest shippers in the globe. And we'll see if this actually pans out as a new way to start assessing sort of what to expect in the economy and certain entities like Walmart that have started increasing their shipping. And therefore, these numbers are related to imports that they're doing relative to Christmas for now. But it's a very minor, small entity. But when you multiply across a number of organizations, I think that could be actually big news in terms of us now having a new vehicle for sort of economic growth and development that might be useful and something to think about. At any rate, I want to thank you for taking time out to review our Tesla semi/electrification mode in this show, obviously focused on what's going on logistically and why the semi makes a difference, even if they're not buying necessarily the Tesla in particular. Next, I want to move on to our usual discussion of health tips. One of the things we covered last time that I'm sort of diving more into is a concept called complex carbohydrates. So for example, when you think of food with rice, vegetables, rice, and a meat dish, for example, one of the challenges there, the rice portion of that is pretty much sugar. So a switch into sort of more veggies, you know, slash protein, but very little carbs, you know, obviously is a great diet choice that a lot of people have been using. But I was actually surprised to learn that there's a lot of diabetic issues that roam into Asia and other places because we're actually focused on kind of, well, what's going on with diabetes relative to the consumption of processed foods, but those processes could include higher consumption of rice, for example. So I thought that was an interesting element of the eating habits, just to remember 25 leg lifts per day per leg with a 5 pound weight is good. Even if you don't have the 5 pound weight, it's still a good idea. Also, don't forget, prior to love making, a good idea to have a small salad or something of that ilk, because it minimizes the amount of blood flow that goes to your stomach, and therefore it's available for other extremities, something to think about. At any rate, this is Greg for Teslafaninsight. Thanks once again for joining us. Again, reminder, please join us on Patreon if you can. I look forward to our show tomorrow on some investment ideas that we did not cover today relative to Tesla's current stock price and its recovery. And thanks again for joining us. Have a great day. Bye for now. Lehitrot. Здравствуйте. Hello. Ni hao ma. Hello. How are you in Chinese? Namaste. Hindi. Arrivederci. Italian. And in Jamaica, we say enough respect. Walk good month. Thanks for joining us. Have a great day. And bye for now.